This is from the first chapter in my book, The Search for Being, George Kelly's Perspective, Construing Reality. You are about to read a number of different systems of construction that are provided to stimulate thought about being. Psychologist George Kelly gave more than a little thought to our being. Our universe, he said, is not static. There was always something happening in it. Our experience, George Kelly said, is that portion of it which is happening to us. Kelly saw the world as a continuity that flows along rather than is composed of independent events. Unlike the idealists or those who see reality as mine, to Kelly, reality was real. But we do not have access to it, he said. We are always only dealing with our constructs, with our ways of representing to ourselves what we see. Any notion we may have is the result of how we construe reality, not of how reality is. Reality, said Kelly, we can never know. We can say, thus is so, said Kelly, but that doesn't make it true. We never perceive reality apart from our construction of it. We select elements from the flow in a process of abstraction, slicing off a manageable chunk, fixing labels or words to these abstractions. There are an infinite number of alternate chunks we could have sliced, alternate constructions we could make of this world of constant change. We try to make sense of flow by looking for recurrent themes. Only when a man attunes his ear to recurrent themes in the monotonous flow does the universe begin to make sense to him, said Kelly. Thus we try to see patterns in the movement of life. It is these patterns that Kelly calls constructs. Without these patterns, Kelly continues, what is takes on the appearance of an undifferentiated homogeneity. Take away a person's system of construal of what is, and she feels she is being swept away. We orient ourselves in the world by viewing things through our verbal and pre-verbal constructs, he believed. Rather than being fluid, maintains Kelly, our thinking is channelized. We think about things by following a network of channels. These channels are our constructs, our working hypotheses of how things are. A construct, said Kelly, is a way of seeing some things as being alike and by the same token as being different from other things. Binding things in constructs gives us some control over what we see. We can think of a construct, said Kelly, as a pathway of movement. Kelly tells us our construction systems set the limits beyond which it is impossible to perceive. Thus, construing and experiencing go together. Kelly liked the term apperception rather than perception to indicate that our previous experiences impact on what we are able to perceive. We test our construing through our behavior, Kelly maintained. How we behave reflects our understanding of the world. Our behavior could be thought of as an experiment in which we test our theories about life. Thus, we can look at our behavior and try to figure out what constructions lie behind it, Kelly said. For instance, let's say something breaks in your home, and you call a handyman to come and fix it. You construe yourself as rather incompetent when it comes to fixing things around the house, so you seek help. You call this particular handyman because he has done a couple of jobs for you in the past, and you construe him as fair and honest. The handyman tells you he will be there in 3 days to look at the job. You don't know anyone else to call, so you wait the 3 days, even though you construe the mess you are in as intolerable. When the handyman finally comes, he asks a price for the work that surprises you because it is so high. But you agree to let him do the work. When it is done, you look at the finished job and ask yourself how you could have been so stupid as to pay so much to have this job done. You can understand your behavior, according to Kelly's personal construct theory, by figuring out how you construed the situation. Your constructions might have gone something like this. There was no one else to call. This handyman is fair and honest. You were incompetent to do it yourself. The mess was intolerable. In each construct we use to view events, there is a bipolar aspect, Kelly tells us. You experience the handyman when he did jobs for you in the past as fair and honest. The other pole of that construct would have been to construe the handyman as unfair and dishonest. You experienced yourself as incompetent at fixing things. The other end of that pole would have been to construe yourself as competent at fixing things. You experienced the mess as intolerable. The other end of that pole would have been to construe it as tolerable. You created what you saw by how you represented the situation to yourself. The attributes you ascribe to the handyman, to yourself, and to the situation were the result of your interpretations. Kelly would have us replace the notion of truth with the notion of our hypotheses about what is true. We all try to anticipate what will happen in our world, Kelly explained. We look at the undifferentiated stream of circumstance flowing past us and we try to find something about it that repeats itself. You predicted that the handyman would be fair and honest because that was the trend you observed on two previous occasions. We choose the pole in a dichotomous construct that improves our ability to anticipate reality. When a construct doesn't work, we can revise it or replace it, Kelly believed. You might replace the construct that the handyman is fair and honest with the construct the handyman can be expensive, or that the other pole of the construct, that the handyman is unfair and dishonest. One way we can start identifying new choices is to become aware of the opposite pole of some of our constructs and then experiment with new hypotheses, said Kelly. We always faced, at the very least, a dichotomous choice in any move we make in life. The poles of our construct can remind us of the paths we aren't taking in life, of the new constructions we might experiment with. You could, the next time something breaks, view yourself as competent to fix it and experiment with that way of construing events by behaving differently. Kelly described people as being like scientists. We were like scientists in that we predict and control events. We form hypotheses and test them out with our behavior, Kelly contended. Then we look at the evidence of the outcome to either validate or invalidate what we anticipated would happen. Thus, each day's events brings evidence that causes us to consolidate some parts of our way of construing life, to revise others, and to relinquish those that don't work, Kelly said. But we can only move along the axis we have laid down for ourselves. Our being is the result of what we undertake. Although the possibilities available to us in life were infinite, without imagination, we would not avail ourselves of them, Kelly contended. Our behavior might only move in the well-worn ruts of channels we have always moved in. Yet whatever we perceive can always be questioned and reconsidered. There are always alternative constructs through which we can view events. Any event can always be looked at in a variety of ways, he maintained. Our ideas can enslave us, Kelly said, but reconstruing our lives could set us free. It is our ability to represent our environments that renders us free, Kelly said. We are free to choose alternative ways of construing what is, said Kelly, including ourselves. But in order for our behavior to change, our constructs had to change first. The rest of this book will attempt to help us to do that, because the first step in reconstruing your life is to find alternative ways of construing who you are and what you conceive reality to be.